More than 12 million men, women, and children pass through these halls. One of the greatest migrations in human history. In these rooms, they were interrogated, inspected, and processed. On these benches, they waited, hoping for permission to pass over to the new land. Ellis Island, where millions of immigrants completed one long journey and began another. For most, this was the threshold to a new life. For others, a closed door of despair. Tens of thousands of immigrants were turned away here and sent back. It was an island of hope and an island of tears.
She told him, I don't want no wars, I don't want no famine, I don't want no poverty, I do not want to raise my children in this country any longer.
There was no work, and you didn't want to be poor all your life.
The great human tide arose from the troubled conditions of turn-of-the-century Europe. It was a Europe of Cossacks and pogroms, of conscription, and the bone-eating poverty of Calabria and Donegal. Overpopulation, unemployment, and persecution forced millions to abandon their farms and villages for an uncertain future across the sea. In America, they had heard, there was land to be farmed and cities to be built. In America, there was hope.
But the main thing is this, more for poverty, of course, you see. I had some friends there. A little sorry to leave them. But, you see, the hope was so tremendously that you live a different life entirely. You get all the liberty and freedom. And you have your hopes up. And that covers almost everything else.
The immigrants swarmed into the great port cities of Europe to be processed for passage to America. Steamship companies competed for their trade. There was profit in the endless stream of self-loading human cargo. More than 1,000 passengers could be packed into the deep bottom of the ship in steerage. Many were willing to go, but few were prepared for the trauma of crossing the Atlantic cramped below the waterline in near darkness with almost no ventilation.
We had very bad days on that ship. Inside, you didn't see light and you didn't see anything. And most of the people were seasick.
The sea was bad, very bad. They used to close the hatch. The room would be closed in. To tell you the truth, it was filthy.
One night I prayed to God there to go down. I was that sick, I didn't care if it went down or not. Like everybody else was just the same way. That's how sick we were.
The journey lasted weeks. When seas were calm, those with blankets came on deck to briefly escape the throbbing engines, spoiled food, and sour air of steerage. America seemed a long way off.
Just wondering where you were coming to or what was going to happen to you.
There's only one thing in my mind. I wanted to get out of there and to come to America.
Finally, the voyage was over. They approached the new land. Those who could massed on deck, voices stilled, eyes straight ahead, seeking through the spray of the sea the figuration of a statue.
finally saw it, and everybody like that, I screamed, and it was really a joy.
The whole world was lit. It was good to see, I tell you.
We could see the silhouette of New York itself. Just something unbelievable that there could be a city this large, and this is where we were going to go.
I'll never forget it. My grandfather said, "You see that? That's a lady." With the passing of the years, he said, "You will realize what that statue means to you. That represents libertà, liberty."
Everybody was just waiting to get off that, standing waiting to get off that ship.
The immigrant quickly discovered that in America, as in Europe, an economic class system separated the haves from the have-nots. First and second class passengers were processed by customs officials right on board. Then they were free to go. Those traveling steerage crowded onto ferries and were taken to a small island in the upper harbor. Relieved that the terrible ocean journey was behind them, they were apprehensive about what lay ahead. Their fate would be determined on Ellis Island.
I was very impressed. That house was so big. I never saw such a house.
No belongings. We didn't even have a trunk. That's all we had, the clothes on our backs.
They would come right into the big hall, and they didn't know where they were. It was a new land, but they hadn't been in land. It was just a big hall.
We were all herded like we were cattle. It was just one human mass of people, bewildered, black and white, people who weren't speaking English, couldn't understand each other. To me, it was just horrible.
As many as 5,000 immigrants entered the Great Hall on Ellis Island each day. As they struggled with children and baggage, they were watched by a team of sure-eyed doctors who made note of the man who wheezed, the woman who limped, the child with the glaring rash. America wanted the person who could work and who was not bringing into the country an infectious disease. When doctors spotted a suspect, they moved in quickly, using chalk to mark the immigrant for further medical inspection. H for suspected heart problem, L for limp, X for mental illness.
And all these doctors, they examine you.
If nothing was the matter with you, you were lucky. You would get through. If you weren't, you were detained.
Even before they left the old country, many had been told to beware of the eye man on Ellis Island. A medical officer placed an ordinary button hook over each newcomer's eyelids, swiftly folding them back to inspect the inner lining for signs of trachoma, a contagious eye disease. The physical inspection was often the most dreaded part of the process, for a failed exam would lead to almost certain deportation. Judgment was swift. Families were separated.
They would announce those who were going to be still detained and those who were going to be deported. And you can imagine what went on there, the screaming and the hollering. And the, oh, it was something.
The poor things that were detained, I felt sorry for them. There were some of them detained and sent back. Many were sent back. Oh, yes.
before I looked around, the day was gone. I didn't know what's going to happen to me. We just said goodbye and they were gone. All by myself.
Corralled into a series of aisles and pens formed by 7-foot-high iron railings, each immigrant waited to see who would be let in and who would not. Did they have all the proper papers in order? Would they understand the questions in this strange new language? Would they be singled out for even more inspection? For the vast majority, the process would last less than a day. But that was little consolation, as they now nervously waited their turn, exhausted and bewildered. Across the water, the immigrant could still clearly see the statue. They had come so far, but were not yet in America.
I decided if they ever have to send me back, I'll jump down to the water and never go back to Russia. I never want to see it again.
Separated from our parents. My father and mother had problems with their eyes and they had to be in the hospital there at Ellis Island. And each person got a blanket and we were given cots.
At night, Ellis served as a dormitory for the thousands who had been detained. The island's hospital included a 450-bed contagious disease unit, locked wards for those deemed insane, operating rooms, and a morgue. Over the years, 3,500 immigrants would die here. 355 would be born. Ellis Island was a small town in its own right. Housing and feeding its temporary residents each day was a major undertaking. The dining room, built for 1,500, was often too small. Meals had to be served in shifts.
We would see these very beautifully set long tables with napkins and dishes of butter and bread. As soon as they opened the doors, the butter and bread would disappear because people were so hungry. It was a sort of a bedlam often in the dining halls. I had my first taste of a banana, which I did not like, but I had my first taste of a ham sandwich, which I loved. Boiled ham sandwich. I've never tasted anything so good.
To me, the white bread was like cake already.
Each day, a new tide of immigrants filled the great hall, and the process began again. Hopefully, their documents would be in order. Hopefully, they would receive a clean bill of health. Hopefully, they would be allowed to pass over to the new land. For most immigrants, the man they faced across the registry desk was the one who would make the final determination.
You know a word of English.
I couldn't understand English, not one word.
First question, how much money have you got?
She had to have £5. My father, I remember, gave me that £5.
Do you know how long? It took a couple of years, 2 and 3 years, to get that $25.
He kept writing and finalized the application and then asked my mother to sign it. And of course, she couldn't sign it because she didn't know how to sign her name. A custom lady told her to X. So my mother put an X. And that was how our application was approved.
But then they said, all right, you can go.
You're free to go.
To Hoboken.
The new immigrant was about to begin yet another journey. From here, they would pass to 1,000 points across America. There was the Hungarian farmer, destination Ohio. The Italian servant girl, destination New York. The Romanian domestic, destination unknown. Single women were not allowed to leave the island unless escorted by a relative. Fiancés who had come to America to join their husbands-to-be often married them on Ellis Island and were then free to go. There would still be many questions to ask. There was still the strange language to try and understand. But for now, the immigrants' future seemed bright. The island had passed them through. The door to America had opened.
My grandfather said, "You don't know what it is today, but I'm quite sure," he said, "that you will thank God that you are in this country."